The Author's Shelf.
The Author's Shelf.
The Author's Shelf.
The Author's Shelf. It's about books and stuff.
Good afternoon, I'm Georgie Donahay and welcome to The Author's Shelf. Each fortnight on 2SSR, we will chat with authors and publishers and those who, like me, love the book industry. We'll bring you stories from beyond the page. Now, before we get into today's show, I'd like to have a bit of an Oscars moment. Hope you'll bear with me. I'd like to thank 2SSR for giving me the opportunity to bring my show to air and for welcoming me as part of the 2SSR family. Thanks to the very talented Glenn Whitehall and the students from Gymea Bay Public School for our intro. Thanks also to my family and their endless encouragement, and to my mentor, the gorgeous Yasmin Kemmel. Thanks for showing me the ropes. Okay, the music's getting louder. Everyone knows what that's meant. That means it's my cue to get on with the show. Now it's time to introduce our very first guest here on The Author's Shelf. This talented author is one of my favourite children's authors, and she's a YA author as well. She's had 7 picture books, a YA book, 6 junior fiction novels, and chapter books, plus numerous books for the education and novelty markets. I'm delighted to introduce the dazzling Sue Whiting. Now I can say that because I've seen this lady engage a room full of kids, and she just lights up the room. Sue, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Georgie. That was a lovely welcome and congratulations on the show.
Thank you very much. Now, Sue, you were a shy girl growing up. I believe you're not in the Shire anymore.
I'm close though, just down the road.
Tell us a little bit about growing up in the Shire.
Well, I grew up in Como West, so I went to Como West Public School, which was a lovely little, I always felt it was a little bush school in the middle of Sydney, and went to Janelle Girls High. And spent an awful lot of time at Cronulla Beach, my favourite haunt during my teenage years.
Oh, very nice. Perhaps that's where the inspiration for your book you're going to talk about a little bit later came from. How about you tell us a little bit how you got into this industry?
Well, I started out my working life as a primary school teacher and had no interest in writing or publishing or any knowledge in the field. And I started to develop a passion for children's book as a teacher. And I did a course when I was doing my fourth year, when I'd been teaching for a few years, in children's literature because of my interest there. And I had to write a children's book as part of that course. And it was really quite an interesting thing for me because I went from someone who had absolutely no interest in writing to an invisible switch flicking on in my brain, and this desire, this came from nowhere, to write and to be a writer. So it grew from there. It was about 10 years festering. I did nothing, didn't act on it because I thought it was a strange thing to happen because I had never really been a writer before that. So after about 10 years of dreaming, I decided to give it a go. So I started out as a writer and writing children's book scripts and sending them out to publishers and getting all those nasty rejections, and which is all part of the industry. And it sort of grew from there. From there, I sort of ended up getting some editing jobs out of the blue, and next thing I knew, I was actually working for a publisher. So life has some strange twists and turns.
Now, I've got quite a few of your books in with me today, actually. A bit of a closet. Well, not a closet fan, but a vocal fan of Sue Whiting's. I've got Elephant Dance here, which was illustrated by Nina Rycroft, and it has some elephants dancing. My daughter, this is one of her favourites, although she tells me this morning that You Wish Jellyfish is her new favourite. You've also written Please Go to Sleep, which is another picture book. Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairies, which was actually narrated by
Antonia Kidman.
Yes, very nice. And you've also done Taming Butterflies and Uncle Alien, Get a Grip, Cooper Jones. You've done lots of books. This is only a sample of some of the ones I've bought in. Which is your favourite one? Which one did you enjoy writing the most?
Well, it's interesting as you went through that, that little pile there, they each have their individual memories and have a special place in my heart, I suppose. Elephant Dance, which I remember was your daughter's favourite a long time ago, is an interesting one because it goes actually right back to that initial story that I wrote that that turned on that switch.
Wow.
And it was a story about a dancing and singing hippopotamus. It wasn't a very good story, but it was a good idea. And so Elephant Dance actually was inspired by that story. So it's a little bit of a homage to that particular moment in my life. So that one has a special place. And they all have their fun moments, and all of them have their difficult moments. But I think the novel that came out in April, my first young adult novel, Portraits of Selena, was the one that, well, I've certainly invested the most time in. And although at times it was very difficult to write, I also had a lot of fun writing it, particularly the more darker, sinister parts of the story, which I hadn't written those type of stories before. So I found that really a lot of fun, and found another side of me that I didn't know existed again.
We're going to talk about Portraits of Selena later on the show. That I love that book, and I want to dedicate some time to that because it's just, it's great. I love that book. Okay, so what advice would you give to somebody who's an up and coming and aspiring writer and wants to be where you're sitting right now?
Okay, the first thing, there's a couple of things. Firstly, I think you need to remember that it's a craft, writing, and that it takes a lot of work. And I was very impatient. Once I decided that I wanted to be a writer, I wanted to be a writer now. And I was writing and writing and writing and sending things out and not really doing my homework and understanding the industry and understanding the craft. After a while, I learnt my lesson, and I learnt that I did have to develop that craft and work on it. So that's number one, is to, you know, to read lots and to write lots and to do whatever you can to improve your writing and to develop your craft. And I think the other thing that you must remember if you really want to be a published writer is don't give up. You have to persevere. You have to keep on practicing. You have to be passionate about what you do, but you have to keep on persevering. And if you keep on, keep at it and keep on persevering and keep on trying, I think for most people it does eventually happen. It just takes a long time sometimes.
It's not a case of, you know, an overnight fairy tale, I guess, like J.K. Rowling had or something. But she
well, got that's what I was going to say. Absolutely, and I think she'd been a writer for a long time before that too. It's that classic story of the overnight success that took 10 years in the making. And I think most people that appear to be overnight successes actually have done a lot of hard yards over a long, long period of time to get to that point. It's just that the public have never heard of them before.
No, and they don't see that, so they just see this, you know, this new author, and they've got a fantastic book, and everyone's lining up to buy it.
But occasionally that does happen. That does happen occasionally. And I don't know that it's healthy, because it's a tricky business, publishing. And I think too much success too soon may not be good long term for some people.
Absolutely.
So, you know, embrace the struggle.
You have to earn your stripes.
Yes, that's right.
Girl, my guest today is children's author extraordinaire Sue Whiting. Sue, you must really love the book industry, because not only are you an author, but you also work as a publishing manager for Walker Books. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, this is another one of those twisty paths in my life. So about 8 years ago now, I left teaching and took up the role as editor at Walker Books. And Walker Books Australia is a company that is part of the Walker Book UK group and also Candlewick Press in the US. And Walker Books had been in Australia for a number of years, but mainly as a sales and distribution point for Walker UK and Candlewick Press. But 8 years ago when I came on board, the company had grown to a sufficient level to support its own local list. So I started, along with Sarah Foster, the managing director and publisher, the Australian list. And so it's been steadily growing over the last 8 years. I think the first year we started publishing, we published about 7 books, and now I think we're in the 90s. So we've grown very, very quickly. We've gone from a publishing staff of one, and now we've got about 10. And so I've grown along with that role, and now I'm the manager of the team of designers and editors that we have that work on creating all these books. We also, 2 years ago, bought the Black Dog Books imprint. So we have Marianne Ballantyne in Melbourne working on those. So the company has grown, and as publishing manager, I'm also an editor. So I have a list of authors and illustrators that I work with developing their books, and as I said, and manage the rest of the team and and the list and the production schedule and all those things. So it's a totally different thing to being a teacher. And I can remember when I first started at Walker Books after being a teacher for 25 years, I was sitting at my desk waiting for the bell to ring to tell me I could go and have a cup of coffee and go to the loo. It's such a different world, you know, the office world compared to the school yard.
Did anyone leave an apple on your desk?
At school?
No, not
at Walker Books. I don't think they realised what a foreign place it was for me, you know, going into an office for the first time, you know, at age 45 or whatever age I was at the time. So it's a great job. I feel very privileged to work with all these wonderful authors and illustrators to make beautiful books, and Walker Books do make gorgeous books. So I feel very, very, very fortunate.
They do. They've got a great author on their on their books, actually, Sue Whiting.
Yes, I do publish there now as well.
The books, they're exceptional quality Walker Books. They're, you know, good. The paper is great, and the illustrations and everything. A great team, and that you put all these books together. On average, how many submissions would you get in a week? I mean, you always hear those stories about some publishers getting hundreds, some getting thousands, some getting only a handful.
We don't get hundreds because we're actually closed for unsolicited manuscripts, which we had to do because we just didn't have the human resources to give them the time that they needed. And we don't really like that fact, but it was just a fact of life. So I couldn't actually give you a number as per week, but I can tell you that the pile of manuscripts that we all take from to read, or the editors, is right behind my desk, and I can see it. I can visualize it right now. It's a very tall pile, and it's sort of something that I don't know if people realise that a lot of the reading of manuscripts is done in your own time. We simply don't have time. It's a very busy business, like most businesses. And so most of our time, office time, is taken up with creating books. And the actual reading of the manuscripts for me happens a lot on the train, where I commute up to Newtown every day from Stanmore Park. And in my own time, I have a pile beside my bed. So we do, even without accepting unsolicited manuscripts, we do receive an awful lot of manuscripts through agents, through our own authors, and through myself and Sarah Foster and other editors going out and soliciting manuscripts, looking for new talent at festivals and so forth.
Right. Okay. So if someone wanted to get a manuscript in front of the Walker Book staff, what would they do? You close for submissions. Do you open for submissions at any time during the year?
Occasionally we do. We have plans in place to do that at certain points,
right,
and we just have to get ourselves organised to do that. But how we would, the best thing I think for those people who are interested in publishing with Walker Books who is unpublished, well, first of all, you can try to get an agent, because we do accept manuscripts through agents. But I also understand how difficult that can be for a first-time author, but it's not impossible. We have got lots of manuscripts from first-time authors through agents, so it does happen. Anna Branford of the Violet Mackerel series, for instance.
Yes.
And she's a wonderful find and a fabulous talent, and we have a great relationship with Anna. Other than that, I think going to festivals and where perhaps myself or other editors might be is a good place where you can network, and you can, often we open up for a certain time. If we've given a talk or we've been doing manuscript assessments at a festival, we'll open up for a period of time, for a month, for the people who attended those festivals. So there are ways.
Okay. So basically we need to find out what your favourite treat is, and we need to come up and tap you at a writer's festival and say, "Hi, Sue. Oh, hey, here's a bunch of flowers. Here's some chocolates."
Chocolate's much better.
Okay.
Wine's really good too. But no, yes. Oh, look, I love chocolates and I love wine, and flowers are gorgeous. But, you know, it always comes down to
the quality.
The writing.
Yes, absolutely.
And really, you know, invest your time and money in your writing, not in those nice things to give to editors.
Okay, so the chocolates that I've got with my manuscript wrapped around the outside to give you at the end of the show.
They will be delicious, okay. I'm sure, but it will be the writing that will matter.
Yeah, absolutely. But that's okay. One of the things I found, I've got a website, Creative Kids Tales, for emerging children's authors, which you're familiar with. And I found that people don't always read the guidelines. They don't follow the guidelines when they're submitting things to me. How important is that when submitting to a publisher? How important is following the guidelines? Do you get frustrated and throw out someone's submission if you know, they've plastered pictures all over it, written it in crayon, and, you know, haven't followed the the correct procedures?
Well, yes and no. I think following the correct procedures are really important, mainly because we want you to be professional. Your manuscript is our first point of contact with you as an author. And if you haven't followed the manuscript guidelines, if you have not given it the right kind of care that we would expect, or have added things that we've requested not to, or have feel like it's been rushed off, well, that's not giving us a very good first impression of you as an author. And I think one of the things that I've learned, particularly working at Walker Books, and one of the best parts of being an editor, is that you have this wonderful relationship with your authors. You work very closely together in trying to make the very best out of that manuscript and that story to be the best possible book. So the relationship is really important. So if I pick up a manuscript that is, you know, has colourful fonts and has huge writing and has all these tricksy things, it makes me wonder if this is a person who listens, who can take guidance, for instance. So it doesn't, you know, give a good first impression, and first impressions are often really important, particularly when you, as I said before, most of these manuscripts are read in our own time. And so it could be, you know, you'd be a bit tired, it might be late at night, and if you have those things you have to plough through, it's not a good first impression.
No, absolutely. And it's not only the quality of the writing, but as you said, if someone can't follow the guidelines and you want to work with them,
it's not a good look.
No, you're not quite sure if they're going to be able to take on board what you're saying.
And you don't want to give an editor any question marks. You want them just to think, this is great, I want to work with this person. But if anything that can just put a niggle of doubt in their mind might work against you, particularly as you, when you're starting out.
Do you have any other advice that you could give somebody up and coming, apart from, you know, reading obviously, find out what's out there in the market, you know, and not another vampire story. Sorry, I have to say that. I'm just over vampire stories anyway. Reading's very important. Following guidelines is very important. Don't submit to a publisher if they're closed, because they're not going to just open their door for you.
No, it'll be returned.
Perhaps seek out an agent. Anything else?
I think, as I said before, working on the craft, it's all about the story. It all comes down eventually to what you have written. And reading is important. And, yes, reading to see what's out in the market is important, but also just reading to soak up that and immerse yourself in the language of children's books is really important too, and that really helps you to understand how children's books work. We're always just looking for great stories well told, and that should be your aim. And that's, if you can do that, somehow or other, eventually you will find yourself a publisher.
Now, I understand Walker Books are celebrating their 20th birthday this year.
Yes.
Have any special celebrations been planned? Giant cake?
We've had a small celebration in the office already, where we had some lolly bags and some you know, speeches and so forth on, I think, the actual day that the birthday was. We're having a party next month, and it's really probably the marketing people the best ones to answer this question, but I know that they've had lots of campaigns, including one about We Believe in Picture Books. And so that's been their major campaign around the birthday, because, as you know, Walker Books, you know, started off in picture books.
Yes.
And are renowned for their picture books. So we've gone back to our roots and really celebrating our picture books this year, and that's our major campaign for the 20th birthday.
Excellent. All right, now I want to talk to you about your book, Portraits of Selena. And I'm Georgie Donahay. This is The Author's Shelf, and my guest today is Sue Whiting. Welcome back, Sue.
Thank you.
Now, Portraits of Selena, I love this book. There's no secret, I love this book. How did you come up with the story?
Well, this is a bit of a strange one, actually, because I started out writing a very different book, a storyline that I'd been thinking about for a very long time, about a genie named Linguini who lived in the back pocket of a pair of jeans. And the story was meant to be for 9 to 12-year-olds, a comic adventure. And I'd been thinking about it for a long time. I thought this was going to be a fabulous, you know, fun adventure story, and had done lots of research and invested a lot of time in it. And I started to write it. And as I was writing it, I knew something wasn't quite working out, and I couldn't work out what it was. But in my gut, I knew that there was problems with the manuscript. So I asked my daughter, Lizzie, if she would give me some advice. And I have to just add here that that was a very brave thing for me to do, because Lizzie is the type of girl that will tell you exactly what she thinks. And she's also my harshest critic. So it took some courage, and I gave her the manuscript, or what I'd written of it so far, and gave it to her. And she said, she went and read it, and she came back and she said, oh, you know, quite like the beginning, which was high praise for Lizzie, and you know, thought that it was going really well, and loved the part with the chest, and they were trying on the clothes, and then this genie appeared. What were you thinking? And I said to Lizzie, well, this is my genie story. Of course a genie appeared. And she said, oh, this is so not a genie story. Ditch the genie. Which, you know, of course, was not what I wanted to hear, considering that I had invested a lot of time in this genie story. So I did what most obedient parents do, and that was, obeyed my daughter and ditched the genie, because she was right, of course. And once I ditched the genie, I had to think, well, what do I have? And I didn't really have a story anymore. I just had some characters and a situation and some backstory about a girl who disappeared in 1975. In my genie story, the genie had a failed, you know, wish, and that's why Selena from the title had disappeared. And that's all I had were those elements. And I sort of started from there and started to explore the characters, and they were all dealing with a tragic event. It's sort of set in now times. But it was the backstory of Selena O'Malley that kept on coming to the forefront. And Selena, in a very kind of spooky way, started to tell me her story, much the same way as she does to Bailey as a ghost in the book. And so as I was listening to her story and starting to write it down, that's when I realized I was writing a ghost story. And so that's how it came about. I had no intention of writing this story. It happened. Selena O'Malley made it happen.
From your other writing, I was gobsmacked. I'm still gobsmacked. I love that book.
Well, thank you.
And I think it would make a great movie. Anyone out there listening, give it a plug to.
Yes, that would be wonderful.
In the movies industry. If you haven't read Portraits of Selena, I urge you go buy it. Go buy it now. Shops are open. It's a great book. It's the cover of the book is also, she's, you know, a young girl standing there. In not unlike the Dorothy red shoes, there's a shadow and there's a lot of rubble around her, and it's just it is a ghost story, but I think it's more it's a complete story, and it's you know, murder and mystery and all those elements
and revenge.
And I didn't find revenge, and I didn't find reading. I was reading a YA book. I felt it equaled, you know, other books that I've read in the adult market. I was enthralled the whole time, and
you're very kind. Thank you.
I loved it, and I'll be selling it on the corner after the show if you like. Come and purchase a copy from me. How do you celebrate once you've completed a book? How do you celebrate?
Well, when do you complete a book? You know, there's different points along the road of writing the book that you sometimes, you know, when you finish your drafts and about to send it to your publisher, you're thinking, oh, I'm finished. But of course, deep down, you know, it's not finished. And I think when you actually finally sign off on your manuscript or your pages, your typeset, and it's about to go to press, in many ways, that is the time when the book is finished. But it's really a kind of an odd feeling. There's a feeling of great relief and we finally got there, but it's actually also, particularly with a book like Portraits of Selena, which I'd invested many years in writing, there's a feeling of great trepidation and also a feeling of loss almost, because you can no longer tinker with the story. It's no longer yours. You're about to give that story over to your readers, and the readers are going to make of it what they will with their own imagination. So you lose control and you can't do anything else with it. So in one way, it's a celebration, but in another way, you feel great loss of handing over this story to other people and saying, okay, well, here's my story. You can take it and do whatever you want with it now. It's yours, and which is a great thing, but it is sort of a scary thing. But, you know, I suppose once it comes out, then you get a chance to crack open some champagne and talk about it a lot.
And I need to say thank you very much, Lizzie, for talking you into getting rid of that genie, because I think the one that you've got works much, much better than
she was right.
The genie,
I have to admit it. She's overseas at the moment and can't hear this, so
you can say
I can say that.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Okay. All right. Now I believe you have a new book coming up. It's coming out next month, A Swim in the Sea. It's a perfect picture book for summertime. Now I'm going to give you a chance to pitch your book to our listeners. We'll take a short break, and when we return, Sue will give her pitch for A Swim in the Sea.
Our electricity bills seem to be getting pretty expensive. I guess having kids means we've got more people in the house using more stuff. We got blue in the face asking everyone to turn off the lights. What else can we do to save some electricity and money?
If you want to make big savings fast, look at the things that use the most energy. Usually these are activities that involve heating or cooling or moving something heavy. Hot water can account for about 40% of your energy bill. So reducing your hot water use by taking shorter showers, washing in cold water, and watching where hot water is used is a great start. If you've got a beer fridge, unless you're emptying it every day, turn it off and only use it when you need to. One old fridge in a shed will be costing you upward of around $200 a year to run. If you're heating your home, make sure you keep your thermostat set between 17 and 19 degrees. Every degree higher adds 10% to your bill. And also keep your cooling set between 24 and 26 degrees. And stop the standby. Standby power is like a vampire that sucks energy slowly and silently, and is used in most electronics and remote control appliances. And although it's doing almost nothing, it adds 10% to your electricity bill. It's easily fixed by flicking the switch on all electronic devices at the power point. To find out more information on how to live sustainably, visit www.livingthing.net.au.
This project has been assisted by the New South Wales Government through its Environmental Trust.
You're listening to The Author's Shelf on 2SSR 99.7 FM, Sound of the Shire. It's currently 12:42 and sitting at 23.8. Okay, Sue, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, take it away.
Okay, A Swim in the Sea. This is my brand new picture book. It's illustrated by Meredith Thomas. It's a story of Bruno, who's very, very excited because today is the first day he's ever, ever in his life going to the beach, and he's going to go for his first ever swim in the sea. But of course, when he gets there and gets up close and personal, he discovers that the sea is not quite what he expected it to be. Of course, as we all know, it can be quite a frightening thing for a small child to see the sea for the first time. So in the story, I try to capture that enormous excitement and anticipation of that much look forward to event, and also that disappointment and trepidation when things don't turn out as planned. With the flags this weekend just being put up at Stanmore Park Beach, marking the beginning of the beach season and summer, this book, I think, is the perfect summer read for three-year-olds and older, 3 to 7. It's the holiday read for that age group. It can be used also as a good springboard for discussion about the sea with teachers and classrooms and beach safety and being sun safe. So it's in stores in October 1. In fact, it'll probably be in stores in the next week or so. And it comes, very excitedly, with a free Swim in the Sea activity book that has mazes and, you know, colouring in and all those kinds of things.
Wonderful. So something to do when you get home from the beach.
From the beach, absolutely.
Excellent. Well done. I think you've done these pictures before, Sue. I really do.
Thank you.
Okay,
one or two maybe.
As Sue said, A Swim in the Sea, is available next month from all bookstores. Sue and Walker Books have generously donated not one but two copies for us to give away on today's show. All you need to do is pop over to our Facebook page, The Author's Shelf, and tell us what the little boy on the cover of the book is doing. We'll announce the winners at the end of the show. We've put a copy of the cover on the Facebook page for you, so we're not expecting you to just have a guess. Have a look. Tell us what you think. And please be advised, this giveaway is for Australian residents only. It's The Author's Shelf on 2SSR, and we'll be right back.
Set upon an argument, I believe we place our happiness. happiness in other people's hands. I believe the junk food tastes so good because it's bad for you. I believe your parents did the best job they knew how to do. I believe that beauty magazines promote low self-esteem. I believe in love when I'm completely by myself alone. I believe in karma. What you give is what you get returned. I believe you can appreciate real love till you've been burned. I believe the grass is no more greener on the other side. I believe you don't know what you've got until you say goodbye. I believe you can't control or choose your sexuality. Trust is more important than monogamy. I believe your most attractive features are your heart and soul. I believe that family is worth more than money or gold. I believe the struggle for financial freedom is a fair. I believe the only one to disagree, a millionaire. I believe in karma, what you give.
SR, supporting Australian talent.
SRFM Shire Weather Watch.
We can expect a mostly sunny start to the school holidays tomorrow with top temperatures due to reach 28 degrees. Tuesday looks to be a little warmer, sitting around 29, while Wednesday will be much the same, sitting around 29 also. Now let's hear about something that's happening around the Shire. Do you enjoy reading and discussing classic literature? Everyone is welcome to join the Classics Open Book Groups, a daytime and evening group which will be held on the first Tuesday of the month. Daytime groups held at Carringbar Library from 2 till 3.30 at 376 Port Hacking Road. Their contact number is 9524 3803, and the evening group is at Sutherland Library from 6:30 to 8 p.m. 30 to 36 Belmont Street, and their number is 9710 0351. Okay, now you're listening to The Author Shelf. Good afternoon.
National Breast and Ovarian Cancer Centre presents a breast check technique, the radio ad break. Step 1, stop whatever you are doing. Step 2, check that no one can see you. Step 3. Use this ad break to get to know your breasts. Look at them. Feel them. If you notice an unusual change, see your doctor. Now resume radio listening as normal. For more information, visit cheekycheckup.com.au.
Don't forget you can listen to us online via TuneIn Radio or logging on to 2SSR.com.au. We'd love to hear about your comments from the show. Maybe there's something you'd like us to cover. If so, you can email me, georgie@theauthorsshelf.com.au. I'm chatting with Sue Whiting. Sue. A Swim in the Sea. We've just covered that, haven't we? All right, let's listen to some music. This one's for Charlotte, and it's Bridget Mendler with Hurricane.
Think the clouds are clogging up my brain like the weather drain, same as the tears on my face. And I'm stuck up in the storm. I guess I'll be alright. Then it hits me like, oh no. And you're that wind that swept me off my feet, got me flying till I'm crying and I'm down on my knees. That's what Dorothy was afraid of, the sneaky tornado. Up my insides, can't hide it on the outside.
I'm chatting with Sue Whiting. Welcome back. Sue, what books do you like to read?
Well, I read all sorts of books. I read obviously a lot of children's and young adult books because that's my interest, and so I read enormous amount, particularly of young adult literature. And then apart from that, I have quite an eclectic taste and read things from crime novels to thrillers to I like stories with great characters that take me on a journey. And I suppose my favorite book of all time, well, I've got two favorites actually, and that would be To Kill a Mockingbird and The Book Thief. So To Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee and The Book Thief by Marcus Zusak, who is actually a Shire boy too.
And it's also being made into a movie.
I can't wait for the movie. I know it's going to be very exciting. I'm really hoping that they do it justice, but I think reading things from Marcus, it sounds like they are. So fingers crossed on that one.
Did I read correctly? Jeffrey Rush?
I think I heard something about that. Yes. Okay. Yeah. So it has to be good then, doesn't it?
It does. It does. Okay. All right. Let's have a bit of a chat about social media. Social media obviously has become a very important resource. People can't live without it. Most authors have a presence on Facebook, Twitter, or their own website, or some even have a blog too. Does having this kind of exposure in the market help publishers when signing up new authors?
I think it does actually. I think you can, sometimes we have signed new authors who already have a following, and that does help definitely. And I think it's very difficult for you these days to have a book out there without some kind of presence, particularly if you're writing for young adults or teenagers, because that's such a big part of their life. So yes, I have a website, I have a blog, I'm a new Twitterer. I have a Facebook page, and I think they're all important ways to link with your audience. And it's been quite delightful, particularly with Portraits of Selena, because there's been so many different avenues for people to actually contact you and to give you direct feedback. And to, you know, I've had some really lovely emails and Facebook messages and tweets and what have you, about the book. So it works both ways. You know, you get to connect with your audience a little bit and they get to connect with you back. So.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All right. Now, I mentioned earlier in the show that I have a website for emerging authors, children's authors. So if you're an emerging children's author and you're looking for somewhere to display your work, why not visit my Creative Kids Tales site, creativekidstales.com.au. There you'll find a complete publisher's listing, competition information, writing tips, and a whole lot more. It's a great site to assist you on your journey to publication. Well, that's about almost all from us today. We hope you enjoyed the show. I'm Georgie Donahay, and I'll be back again on Sunday, the 6th of October, with another show. In the meantime, please join us on facebook.com/theauthorsshelf or Twitter @theauthorsshelf. Sue, thank you very much for being our first guest.
Thank you very much. It's been an honour to be the first guest, and all the best with the new show. I think it's a great idea.
Thank you very much. I hope you did enjoy yourself today.
I did. I had fun.
Excellent. And if you'd like to find out more information about Sue or her books, you can visit her website, suewhiting.com. That's Whiting spelt W-H-I-T-I-N-G. Sadly, it's time for us to go. To take us out, here's Dragon with Celebration.
2SSR, supporting Australian talent.
Thanks for joining me on The Author's Shelf. I hope you'll